To conclude this enriching afternoon focusing on sustainable supply chains, the next speakers will take part in a panel discussion to discuss data-driven innovation, a key enabler for more sustainable supply chains. And it will be my pleasure to lead this insightful discussion. Please give a warm welcome to the panelists who will be joining me on stage and also remotely. Jonas Hernlund, Chief Commercial Officer at EINRIDE, remotely. Livia Toth, Ventures Director at Plug and Play, Hamburg, Germany. Olivier Beaujean, Chief Information Officer of Cargolux. And Dr. Rabin Kumar, SAHU, Supply Chain Expert and Researcher from Vekia. So, welcome, everyone who is present. So I think we will start waiting for Olivier Jean from Cargolux. So thank you very much for participating in this panel. I have a general question, which I'll ask Rabin first, please. How do you create a data-driven organization?
That's a quite interesting question. I think data-driven organization, in my view, has to be a top-down approach. And currently, I think leadership are realizing what is the importance of data, be it in sustainability or be it cost optimization. And with data, you can have better optimization and better decisions. You can have any objectives for that matter, whether cost optimization, or you can have higher utilization or that. Coming to how we can make a organization data-driven, for me, it's again a data top-down approach, and it has to be done from the top management.
Mm-hmm. Livia, what are your thoughts?
Can you repeat the question?
Of course. How do you create a data-driven organization?
Yeah, so first of all, like, there is a lot of data available. The most important aspect is that we leverage that data. So what we see also from the industry and all the players that we work with, that they are really looking into all the different solutions that help them leverage the data, enrich the data, find some patterns in that data. And of course, from that space, you have different use cases to optimize warehouse operations, optimize routes that all the vehicles take to ship different products.
And Rabin, can you touch on inventory? Because I believe that's
yes.
Your specialty.
Yes, inventory is my specialty.
Thank you.
So currently, we can do a lot of thing with data regarding inventory. First of all, how do you optimize inventory? Okay, you have certain demand for the end customer. So main thing is, how much inventory at which location you need. So to do that, your first information you need, what is the demand? But that is not the only information. Companies can leverage, where the inventory is located, how much is located, and inside the warehouse also, at what point or which location it's located. And that is really helpful in managing inventory. I'll give you just an example. You have an order, let's say, for the warehouse, and you have a picking list, I need this product. So if you do not have exact information regarding which product is located where, then doing that picking order to make that shipment also, you need a lot of time. And that is where you can leverage data, and the location data is really important for that. It's just an example.
Thank you, Rabin. Thank you very much. So let's ask Jonas the question. How do you create a data-driven organization?
Yeah, I mean, it's a great question, and I think answering that question, I can probably relate to a couple of experiences that I have, both from very old legacy government companies and operating in sort of new, actually data-driven companies like the Googles of the world. So I think really comes down to it being a culture. It's a cultural decision and culture implementation. So do you really want to become data-driven? The implication of that is quite profound. So are you actually willing to commit to being data-driven into your business processes? Because it's very easy not to be data-driven. So if you just think about when Google designed its search engine results page, they were optimizing for the color of blue on the landing page. How many times do you think they did an A/B test for that color of blue, the nuance of the blue? 41 times. Like, and to get to that depth of data-drivenness in a company, that really requires a cultural mind shift. And then it also requires, in terms of decision-making, that you're actually committing to more of a meritocratic, data-driven decision-making, where you're actually saying that, hey, we're not just gonna listen to the hippos in the room, so highest paid person in the room, we're actually just gonna listen to the data and the people that know their shit. So to me, it's really about the culture. It's a culture thing to get it right. And it's really, really hard.
Thank you, Jonas, for those insights. We welcome Olivier from Cargolux. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
The question is, how do you create a data-driven organization? If you could speak about Cargolux, we'd appreciate it.
Yes, thank you. So as already explained by my predecessor here, I think being a data-driven organization is something very difficult. You can summarize it in one sentence, is to be able to deliver insights to the right person in the right format, through the right channel, and at the right time. So it seems easy to really track and facilitate decision-making in the organization, but it's really far from being simple. You really have this cultural challenge. It's not so much technical, it's mainly cultural, I agree, because you fundamentally need to change the culture of your organization as a whole, and to, at all level of the organization, to really be goal-driven, to find the right use cases, to give this information at the right time to the right person, meaning it has to be in the format that is agreed throughout the organization to be able to compare and to interpret the data in the same way. It has to be at the right moment for the decision-making process. It has to be through the right channel, because you will not reach everybody according to personal preferences or their degree of digital savviness, you will not reach them the same way. So it's very, very challenging and mainly cultural. So I agree, this is something pretty difficult, and you have to, not every company is a digital native. So if you want to go that way, you really need to ask yourself, okay, do I really want it, like you said previously? And can I focus really on specific use cases to make it happen, and not to invest, like in the past, in the last decades, millions of euros or into data lakes and collecting data everywhere without really knowing the end goal and the purpose of it? You need to change fundamentally this decision-making model culture in the organization, and that's a fantastic journey, but very difficult to go through it.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Kind of a follow-up to this question, Olivier. What impact can the data-driven organization create toward being more sustainable in your industry, for example?
Well, at Cargolux, we have many initiatives around digital innovation, data-driven innovation. We monitor the mainly the fuel, because that's what is you know, the main driver for us, and the CO2 emission. We have software for that to really collect data from every plane and to optimize the routes and to suggest improvements to reduce the fuel consumption. We also use we also do some predictive maintenance by predicting the failure of certain components on our airplanes, like brakes or oil pump for the flaps. So we collect all those data to really improve our performance and reduce the carbon footprint. We also have databases for, you know, fair trade, for compliance, where we check the countries that are blacklisted or the stakeholders with whom we should not engage into trading. So we use data extensively to those purposes. Now, of course, you have to realize that the global emission of carbon dioxide is 2% for our industry, 4% for maritime shipping. So it's not really a very huge impact compared to other industries like agriculture or heating and electricity for households, etc. But we still have a consortium of airlines, IATA, who's paving the way for a more sustainable future. And they have a lot of initiatives like paperless processes between all the different stakeholders, or one record to facilitate the exchange of data amongst them. And Cargolux is following actively all those initiatives. But what we strive to do is really to go beyond that for ourselves, in order to really have a more sustainable supply chain. And we have a digital innovation team who is always trying to find the appropriate use cases for us to go further, to engage with our customers with a lot of transparency by providing the CEO for every shipment, and by being fully transparent on what we do.
Thank you very much for that. Livia, since you work with startups, I wanted to ask, speaking of sustainable supply chains, what is AI's role in making supply chains more sustainable? And how can they be adopted more easily to be successful?
So definitely there has to be a huge interest and acceptance from the industry. So startups are there in order to find business cases for all their technologies and products that they are developing. So there has to be the welcoming industry on the one hand. And I mean, machine learning, artificial intelligence, all help us leverage the data and leverage the data for additional use cases, right? So some of the use cases that we see in the supply chain and the logistics space, if we look at the entire spectrum, right, then machine learning and artificial intelligence can really serve the spaces from, you know, from the manufacturing, optimizing warehouses, implementing different robotic solutions in the warehouse, inventory management. Then also when it comes to fulfillment and delivery of the shipments. And then when it comes to marketplaces, price comparison, that's also very important. The role of AI is very important there. But what I also want to tap into is also the interest from the end users, the consumers, that they really want to be familiar with the supply chain. So where are all the products that they are using coming from? They want to be aware what they are consuming. They want to tap into the transparency of let it be, you know, food, let it be the clothing that they are using. And AI and all the other technologies are just there to help us make the entire supply chain more visible. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Livia. Thank you. Jonas, I'd like to ask you the same question for your industry. What is AI's role, and how do we make supply chains more sustainable? What are the conditions to make digital innovation enable more sustainability in supply chains?
Yeah, I mean, it's a great question, Carla, and I think we're at this point in time where there's so much data in terms of planning an efficient supply chain, both from a demand and a supply perspective, and connecting the dots between the demand and supply, where in the past this could actually be done by a human person with pen and paper. And then it's evolving into sort of basic Excel TMS functionality, and at one point you have a sort of SAP TMS type of thing going. But what we're seeing now is that without proper data intensity and proper machine learning algorithms, there's just no way that you're going to be able to get the sort of the impact that you need to push this industry. So I mean, case in point, we are looking with autonomous and electric solutions. We are looking to specific use cases. We are looking to reduce 90% of the CO2 of road freight. And if you look at that, you know, across the world, that's 4.5 billion barrels of oil that we could carve out annually. And the only way for us to be able to do this is that we have a real-time connection to the demand of the supply chain, and we're able to optimize this in real time. And there's just no way that, you know, traditional software, non-machine learning type of software is able to do this. So it will be a game changer, but then again, it will be an enabler for reaping these sort of really big disruptions.
Thank you, Jonas. Rabin, I'd like to ask you, in your industry, so inventory, Livia mentioned leveraging data for additional use cases and making the supply chain more sustainable. How do you do that in your industry?
In our industry, or any industry for that matter, if you have a distribution supply chain, where you are transporting products from manufacturing site to the end user. I guess data is, like right now, I would say it's supremely important. What my earlier colleague said is 100% correct. If you are taking a decision just manually, then it cannot be better than a machine-made decision using data. And now we have so much data that human cannot do many things with it. So, okay, we have to have AI or machine learning or any technology which can use at least those amount of data. Now, coming to the specific question of inventory optimization, let's just imagine that you know what all the demands will be in case of e-commerce. The general process is, you optimize your transportation based on, okay, these are the demand points. Now, that what do you mean by demand in e-commerce is, okay, once the order is placed, then there is demand, then, okay, if the product is coming from location X, you plan the deliveries and you plan so that you have a full truckload. Now, going to the next step, what we can do is, let's predict customer behavior. Now let's say, okay, at this Luxembourg location, these many mobiles will be sold, and okay, we are seeing some pattern that, okay, maybe on this day, these many mobiles will be sold without even receiving an order. So that's where AI really comes in predicting the actual demand, so much so that we can start a shipment without even receiving an order. So that's where the efficiency really comes in, and once our deliveries are efficient, it becomes sustainable.
Thank you, Rabin. Thank you. So we have a rather philosophical question, concerning innovation. And people in general want to know, how did Europe lose its innovation edge versus the United States and Asia? I'd like to ask everyone to respond, but and what can be done to regain it, to put Europe back in the driver's seat? Olivier, would you like to tackle this?
Well, as I said, I think the main reason is cultural. I think that in the US, for example, innovation was always at the heart of the whole education system, and taking risks and failing fast and starting again was part of their culture. In Europe, it's more difficult to get to that mentality. A failure, even a small one, is still considered as a failure. So we really need to put in place the organizational capabilities if we want to go that way, with the support of every level in the organization, to infuse a different kind of mindset for the organization and to create this kind of mentality where we want to use the convergence of those technologies to go further and to even change our business models. Because in Europe, for example, the traditional business models are kind of sacred. And if you try to question them in most of the companies, it is really a difficult fight, right? So to be in a position where you can really offer with those with this digital innovation something completely different and a new type of revenue is not an easy task. So I would say yes, you really need to bring those capabilities, infuse this new mentality, even in small groups, start with a proof of concepts to show that this is working, that you can go somewhere with it, be more entrepreneur, which we're all trying to become more and more, but it takes some time to bring those changes, and we're going that way.
Thank you. Yes, we say in America, you're allowed to fail. That's very well said, Olivier. Livia, you work with innovators. What do you think?
Yeah, so it's not that we only work with innovators, but we also work with startups and big industry players all around the world. So we really see the differences when it comes to cultural aspects. And as Olivier said, I can relate to that, that being risk averse here in Europe is still a thing, but we actually see a positive tendency because now corporations and startups are aware that they are less willing to take risks than their counterparts in the US, and that's already a good sign and a good start. So that's one thing. And the other aspect is that in the US, businesses in the US, they are more willing to share their insights. They are more willing to share some of the secrets that, you know, leads them to be successful. And in Europe, they are a little bit secretive. They like to, discuss all the best practices in silos. But as I said, there is a turning point, and we are all aware of not mistakes, but some of the disadvantages that we have, and we are working on improving them.
That's good. That's good. Thank you. Thank you, Olivia. Jonas, what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I think we've had a leadership position, and we've sort of been put on a defense where, if you look at our regulations and our bureaucracies, we're really on the defense, where we are spending a lot of time sort of regulating American and US companies coming to Europe, rather than sort of investing aggressively in helping European companies go outside of Europe. I think that's there is a very big mental shift that needs to happen. But then again, I mean, I completely agree with you, I mean, Livia, partly thanks to the great work that you guys are doing. I mean, just look at the tech ecosystems that we have now in the UK, for example, for fintech, in Berlin, in the Baltics, in the Nordics, and there is some massive change happening. And I think it's just about making sure to put some more fuel to that fire. Mm-hmm. And then we're it's not too late that we can take that leadership position again.
Great. Thank you, Jonas. Rabin, would you like to comment?
You also mentioned Asia, right?
Yes.
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 So maybe I can give one perspective.
Yes,
as
thank
I am
you.
From India. So yes, what you said for the US is true, that okay, they are allowed to fail. Now in Asia, the picture is completely different. There, okay, it's there is a need for innovation, and I will say there is no organized innovation, that okay, you are working in silo and you are doing something. If you see a need, then okay, you are working in silo. We call it jugaad. It's kind of a other name for innovation, but not an organized innovation. So the number of innovation happening in Asia, that's why it's, you can say, higher, but not organized one. Yeah. And where we and it's happening only because there is a need, and it's not as advanced as US or Europe. So they see the need, but there is there is bureaucratic and government complacency in some cases, mm-hmm. where it's people-driven innovation. Okay, you see, you have an idea, you do something, and okay, you get recognition, and sometimes you don't. Mm-hmm. But there is a need to innovate. That's why in Asia the innovation is happening. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you for that.
If I can
ask
to that.
Yes, Livia. Yes, please.
So talking about Asia, I mean, in Asia there are a lot of great talents. And most of the time they don't stay there.
Yes. Yeah, means one reason is, okay, you do not find a right job for the right talent. And that's one of the major reasons where talents don't stay in India or in Asia, for that matter. So, yes.
Thank you. I think this leads into the next question, which is very interesting. I think Livia will like to answer this first. What type of technologies are the best prospects for investment? And what are the ingredients for the development of those technologies?
So first of all, I think from an investor perspective, it's very important to look at also other aspects of a company that we like. Of course, there has to be a great team that is behind the product, that is driving the business behind a certain technology. And first of all, as an investor, we have to have the chemistry. We have to be able to relate to that, and also we have to be able to also want to drive the business together with that company. Also, traction is very important within a certain period of time, gaining traction very, very early on. So these are some of the key factors that we look at. And when it comes to technologies, right, as I mentioned, we look at different spectrums. So last mile delivery, you know, optimizing, automating supply chains. Warehouse optimization is very interesting. Implementing different robotic solutions for inventory management, for example. Also, route optimization and transport management systems. Leveraging the data and different tools for leveraging the data. And then, last but not least, there is also there are also energies that are driving all of these. And recently, we have been looking into renewable energies like hydrogen, biogas, that are super important for the future, mm-hmm. and will be enablers of the transportation.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I think this is a good segue to Jonas, if you'd like to talk about the technologies that you think are the best prospects for investment, and what are the ingredients for their development?
Yeah, I mean, being a technology company ourselves, so we mainly look at it from a buy or build perspective, where we have a reasonably aggressive roadmap from a software and hardware development perspective, also from a go-to-market perspective. So we will be looking at it from, you know, what can a company or a startup help us in terms of accelerating our roadmap or our trajectory, and we'll just compare it to doing it organic. So we have a pretty sort of pragmatic view of doing that, and that's basically how we would go about it.
Mm-hmm. Great. And Rabin, would you like to comment?
Can you repeat the question?
Technologies that are the best prospects for investment and how to further their development within your industry.
Technology, I will talk about AI and what problems their adoption companies face usually. I guess that's one way to look at it, because we know that, okay, AI is good, but once it's not implemented, or one, if you have hardship in implementing, it's of no use. So I would say that is one area where companies can look at. How can they build something with AI which can also be implementable?
Okay, thank you. I'd like to leave the last word for our homegrown cargo airline, which we are so proud of, Cargolux. So Olivier, would you like to comment and
on the
give
same
a last word?
Question?
Yeah, or on another topic if you'd like.
Well, yeah, I believe I agree with Jonas on that. I think depending on the company, the right technologies or companies to invest in would depend on the roadmap you have, your strategy, what you want to achieve, and if you can accelerate it with this this acquisition, because what is really important is to already have the strategy to create those synergies. You know, before you decide to invest in the technology, to really have your a good plan, a solid plan to create all those synergies and to integrate this acquisition very quickly in your organization. So, because buying it as a standalone is usually not not something that works in a lot of cases. So, it depends on each company.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Of course. Well, thank you very much to everyone, Jonas, remotely, for your dynamic engagement during this discussion. So we really enjoyed having you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. You.